You're watching Liberty, the American Revolution on member-supported KCET Los Angeles. Liberty on KCET is made possible by our members and the following. Foothill Capital Corporation, one of America's leading asset-based lenders, providing financing to companies across the United States and Canada. Foothill Capital Corporation, a Norwest company.
Project.
We now return to Liberty, the American Revolution. Liberty, the American Revolution is brought to you by Norwest, banking, mortgage, and consumer finance. We care about our communities and the value of education and are proud to support this series. Norwest to the nth degree. Major funding is also provided by the National Endowment for the Humanities, expanding America's understanding of who we were, who we are, and who we will be. The Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. The Eberle Foundation. The Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
Hello, I'm Forrest Sawyer. There are times when one person's character can change the course of history. As we saw in the last episode, the determination of George Washington saved the Revolution in 1776. In this, the fourth episode of Liberty, you're going to meet another amazing character, British General John Burgoyne. You may never have heard of Burgoyne, but because of events which he set in motion, you and I carry American, not British, passports. In 1777, General Burgoyne had every reason to be confident. The 13 states faced devastating odds. The colonists always had imported manufactured goods from England. So now, they find themselves low on gunpowder, tents, even uniforms. At times, their soldiers must face the British army with little more than sharpened iron spears. The states need help. Without support from a foreign power, the cause and the revolution will be lost.
The French port of Nantes, December 1776. A ship arrives carrying an important visitor from America. England's ambassador to France is alarmed. He sends a secret message to London.
To Lord Weymouth. I learned yesterday evening that the famous Dr. Franklin has arrived at Nantes. Some people think that he has come to France on personal business. I am convinced that he is here on some secret business from Congress. He is a devious man, incapable of truth, and will, I'm sure, try to draw the French into openly supporting the cause of the rebels.
To the French Foreign Minister, we request an audience with Your Excellency when we may have the opportunity of presenting our credentials. We beg to acquaint Your Excellency that we are appointed and fully empowered by the Congress of the United States to negotiate a treaty of friendship and commerce between our two countries. Benjamin Franklin.
Britain and France were traditional enemies, of course. They had fought one another in wars for a long time. And in particular, in the previous war, the French and Indian War, the French had been catastrophically defeated. A very substantial part of their colonial empire had been lost. And what was perhaps even worse than the actual material loss, they were intensely humiliated. The French felt that they had lost their honour in suffering successive defeats at the hands of the British. And there's an intense, bitter yearning for revenge.
The Americans realize that the fate of the revolution depends on France. They have sent their only experienced diplomat to argue their case.
Franklin arrives in France to convince Louis XVI's government that they should come in on the side of these American rebels against their hated enemy, Great Britain. Naturally, the French are reluctant, as eager as they were to seek revenge. They're reluctant to get themselves caught if the Americans should suddenly settle with the British and the French find themselves in a world war with Britain without the support of the Americans. So there's a good deal of suspicion on the part of the French whether the Americans have the stuff to make this revolution stick. So they're looking for victories, which of course they see none.
King Louis XVI refuses to receive Benjamin Franklin. This is not going to be an easy mission. Canada, June 1777. British troops assemble on the banks of the Richelieu River. They plan a major attack on the United States from the north. It is an enormous force, led by the dashing, theatrical, larger-than-life General John Burgoyne.
I can't ask for anything better than this army of professionals. The mob of undisciplined provincials won't have a chance against them. I have instructed the officers to count on the bayonet. The rebels can't stand up against the bayonet. They hide behind trees, relying on their rifle pieces.
Gentleman Johnny Burgoyne was a socialite general, a young man about town, charming, innumerable friends, very competent playwright. Burgoyne, better playwright than general. His farces are still worth listening to.
In England, Horace Walpole, a political insider, comments.
Ah, yes, Burgoyne the pompous. He's the natural son of Lord Bingley, but he did not inherit any of his estate. He's a gambler. Some say he cheats, but in fact he plays very well. I heard him speak in Parliament. He never impressed me much with his brilliance, but he's a useful commander. He feeds the press and the public with many exciting accounts of his exploits. He's as noisy as Howe is quiet.
As a member of Parliament, Burgoyne has used his political pull to get command of this northern campaign. Burgoyne's master plan is for two British armies to seize control of the Hudson River, one attacking down from Canada, the other up from New York City. This would isolate New England from the rest of the colonies.
This is the famous Hudson Lake Champlain Richelieu Corridor, which is one of the most fought over places on earth. Everybody knew that if you could get control of it, you then were master of the northeastern United States. And it was particularly important for the British to have control of it, because then they could use Quebec, Montreal at one end, and New York at the other as their two main bases, and just shoot up and down the corridor. And New England and most of New York would be cut off from the rest of what we'll call the United States. It wasn't yet the United States, but the rest of the United States.
A young soldier fighting with Burgoyne, Sergeant Roger Lamb, keeps a diary of his experiences.
This is going to be a critical expedition. General Burgoyne tells us to get ready. Ready for hard work. Ready to give our lives. We must not retreat.
The soldiers board ships, and Burgoyne's armada sets sail. Their destination is Albany. After Albany is secured, the main British army under General Howe will move north from New York City and take control of the lower Hudson River. This is the master plan approved by London, but it is left up to the generals in the field, Howe and Burgoyne, to work out the details of the operation. They cannot expect to turn to England for help.
The time interval for a dispatch from America to go to home to London to reach ministers in Whitehall to be considered and acted on, and for the consequences to begin to affect things in America, would very seldom be less than 9 months. And if you're talking about trying to organise some major military operation, which obviously takes a long time, then it could be as long as 15 or 18 months before the repercussions begin to make themselves felt, by which time, of course, the chances are the situation has changed out of all recognition anyway.
In New York City, General Howe is making preparations for some large operation. George Washington is with the main American army in New Jersey, watching and waiting for Howe's next move.
General Howe's strange maneuvers puzzle us beyond measure. One day his ships seem ready to head up the Hudson. The next day they seem headed toward Philadelphia. I'm completely perplexed as to what his real design is. Our conduct must be governed by his. If we can keep General Howe at bay, I think any success that Mr. Burgoyne has will be partial and temporary.
Burgoyne's army travels down Lake Champlain, a smooth 3-week sail. On July 1st, they arrive at what everyone considers the single largest obstacle of the campaign, Fort Ticonderoga. The fort dominates a narrowing in the lake. No invaders can get their boats past this point without coming within range of the fort's deadly cannon. This stronghold is being defended by 2,000 heavily armed Americans. Overlooking Ticonderoga is Mount Defiance. It is steep and rugged. Nobody imagines that it can be fortified. But in an extraordinary feat of military engineering, Burgoyne's soldiers managed to cut a path up its back slope. The following morning, the Americans are stunned to see British guns trained down on them. They realize that the fort is indefensible and flee for their lives.
It was a very emotional deal for the Americans. Fort Ticonderoga stood as the great bastion to stop invasions from the north. And suddenly, the British were able to breach it. And this had a tremendous impact on America. The tie had broken, and the British were streaming down the Champlain Valley. It looked like all was lost.
Torrents of success. The opposition is swept away, all of us. Officers and men see the end in sight. Albany within our grasp. New England finally submitting to British rule.
To Lord Germain, nothing can now stop us on our passage to Albany. Credit for this victory goes to my officers and superior equipment. My merit is small. After we take Albany, I request the King's leave to return to England. My constitution is not fitted for the American winter.
In London, an ecstatic King George III gets the news of the fall of Ticonderoga.
I beat them. I have beat the rebels.
In France, Benjamin Franklin's spirit is far from broken. He answers an inquiry from a British scientist with some timely advice for the king.
You ask my opinion on whether King George's palace should have pointed lightning conductors or rounded ones. If I had one wish, it would be that he had no conductors at all. For it is only since he thought himself and his family safe from the thunder of heaven that he dared use his own thunder to destroy his innocent subjects. Benjamin Franklin.
Franklin's hope of an alliance with the French king has been seriously damaged by the American loss of Ticonderoga. But for the French people, this master politician is fast becoming the revolution's greatest salesman.
He symbolized Republican simplicity, the new man emerging from the new world in America. He was a myth. The figure of Franklin was extremely popular. In each French home, there was a portrait of Franklin. His face could be found on the bottom of beer glasses. He was everywhere.
There's a kind of radical chic running through the French aristocracy, a kind of excitement over this new Republican America, and Franklin plays upon it superbly. He is well aware of what he ought to do as a traditional ambassador, but he doesn't behave as a traditional ambassador. He dresses in plain clothes, he wears no sword, he wears no wig, and as you can well imagine in the court of Versailles, this was astonishing for an ambassador to present himself in such a plain manner.
Talk about propaganda. Franklin had a very keen sense of this. He was able to spin images that could incarnate the cause. His movement to the little fur hat was very much in keeping with this. You know, there's a portrait of Franklin looking very much the dandy with his silk vest and his gentlemanly clothes. All that was abandoned for the fur hat. He became the natural American.
Franklin's fur hat and Republican ideas are the rage of Paris high society. But this is not enough to sway the king. Now more than ever, he wants proof, hard proof in the form of military victories, that the 13 states can hold out against the British. Burgoyne's ships have just arrived at the southernmost tip of Lake Champlain. The lake does not connect with his next objective, the Hudson River. The British must now disembark and travel by land. Burgoyne's army of over 8,000 is a huge, unwieldy force. Half are British, half are German mercenaries, the notorious Hessians. Traveling with the army are 2,000 women and a large number of children.
It was a long-standing tradition for enlisted men, in order to keep them in the army, to be allowed to bring their dependents with them. The women in the camp did all the housekeeping chores. They cooked, they cleaned, they nursed, they foraged. They were essential in many ways for the survival of the army.
High-ranking officers and their families live in style. Baroness Frederica von Riedessel is traveling with her husband, the commander of the Hessian troops.
I sent back most of my baggage and have kept only a small summer wardrobe. As we were going to be traveling further, I had a small carriage built with seats for my three children and the servants. So we are traveling in the midst of the soldiers, who are merry, singing songs and burning with a desire for victory. General Burgoyne, he likes to make himself comfortable. He spends most of the night singing and drinking and cavorting with the wife of one of his officers, who is his mistress. She is as fond of champagne as he is.
One of the great mysteries of Burgoyne is how he thought he could carry both his army and all of the baggage and so many what seemed to us superfluous people with him down the backcountry. I mean, he had 30 carts with his personal possessions, including several cases of champagne and changes of clothing. It seemed totally inappropriate to this situation.
Burgoyne is moving through a vast wilderness. This is hostile territory. Every hill, every river presents unseen hazards. To guide him to the Hudson River, Burgoyne has recruited a force of Iroquois Indians.
Both sides, both the British and the colonials, were working for the participation of the Iroquois in the war, although officially they were supposedly urging the Iroquois to remain neutral and stay out of this white man's war.
When it came time for the Indians to choose between the Americans and the British, most Indian peoples found it easy to choose the British instead of the rebellious Americans. For generations, they had been living side by side with the Americans, and they didn't actually like the Americans very much. The Americans tended to move in on Indian lands without asking permission and without having a treaty. It was the British who had tried to keep this kind of land encroachment to a minimum or to eliminate it altogether.
Native American people fought for their own homes. They realized that if the colonists won, that their lands would be overrun. They had no great alliance or great support of the British government, but they realized that the British government was their only hope here in defending their homeland against the colonists. It was the lesser of two evils, but it certainly was the preferred choice.
Those Indian nations which joined the British have sent Burgoyne 400 of their finest warriors. They will be his scouts, the eyes and ears of the invasion. Only 23 miles separate Lake Champlain from the Hudson River. 23 miles of dense, primeval forest of enormous pines and maple trees. Burgoyne's mile-long train of carts, pulled by pack animals, must somehow hack its way through this seemingly endless wilderness. Geography becomes his worst enemy.
People back home can't imagine what this country is like. Hundreds of rivers and lakes. And a person can wander 1,000 miles without meeting another human being. The porcupines are the size of a small dog. Tasty when roasted, like a suckling pig.
Europeans had long since devastated their forests. So when they come to America, they see all of these trees. They're overwhelmed by the forests. There was no New York Thruway to come down on. They had to hack their way through forests and trails. And it was a excruciating experience. It took them months.
The route must cross deep ravines, swamps, and bogs. Burgoyne's soldiers must build 40 bridges and causeways, some over 2 miles long. Progress is excruciatingly slow, less than 1 mile a day. For the Hessians, this is their first taste of the American wilderness.
If I weren't here, I would have never believed that such a terrible place as this exists in the world. It's hot and sticky in the day, and at night it is cold and foggy. Last night we had thunderstorms with much heavier thunder and lightning than I've ever experienced in Germany. In camp we are constantly waging war against the flies. At night, snakes come visit us in our tents. I cannot describe how terrified I am of them.
In New York City, the other British general, William Howe, is loading supplies and 18,000 of his troops onto ships. Washington, with the main army in New Jersey, watches helplessly as Howe's troops set sail. On a clear July day, the armada disappears over the horizon.
All he knew when Howe left in the fleet sailing out of New York Harbor was that Howe had gone out of New York. Where was he going to show up? Was he going to be at Philadelphia? Was he going down to Chesapeake Bay? Washington had to move his army to counter Howe. And he had men all along the eastern seaboard. He possibly might be going down to Charleston. He didn't know. But he had to keep his army mobile and ready to chase Howe to counter wherever he showed up.
Unable to spare any men, Washington makes an appeal to the New England militia to stop Burgoyne's advance.
Gentlemen, General Burgoyne's plan is to cut communications between the northern and southern states. He must be speedily and vigorously opposed. We are looking to your militia for support. Every motive of self-preservation, of liberty and happiness, has a claim on your efforts. General Washington.
As Burgoyne begins to approach more populated areas, he too makes an appeal to the inhabitants.
This crusade is to restore to you the blessings of legal government. You Americans are invited to join us in this glorious task. Civilians will not be bothered if you remain quietly in your homes and make available to our army forage for our animals.
Burgoyne's words have the opposite effect.
Burgoyne talked too much and wrote too much. I mean, it was a very high-profile invasion that he conducted, thanks to his own style of conducting it, and in fact helped to solidify American motivation to resist him.
For nearby farmers and townspeople, the advancing British army has suddenly become very real. The Americans start to assemble into their militia units. The Englishman, Nicholas Cresswell, is finding his travel plans disrupted.
New recruits are collecting in every town on the continent. In a few months, the rascals will be stronger than ever. Even the preachers have turned their pulpits into drums, summoning all to arms among this cursed rabble. Damn them all!
Burgoyne is beginning to encounter scattered opposition. He issues a more ominous proclamation.
To those who continue this stubborn rebellion will come the vengeance of a state against its willful outcasts. The Indian forces under my direction will wreak devastation, famine, and every imaginable horror on those who resist us.
Even though Indians and colonists often got along, trading with one another and forming alliances, most colonial Americans were terrified of the native peoples who were at their borders. These Indians were very effective warriors. They could strike over long distances, suddenly, swiftly, and then disappear again into the forest and head home. As these stories developed over time, they became embellished, they became exaggerated, and they achieved a currency in colonial America that made Indians very feared warriors indeed. General Burgoyne, knowing this fear, used it as a weapon of terror and publicized his Indian allies in northern New York.
But Burgoyne's strategy backfires. In late July, a young woman, Jane McCrae, engaged to a British officer, is brutally murdered.
No one will ever know for certain how Jane McCrae was killed and by whom. But the Americans knew from the very first news of this killing how they would use it. They would use it to great effect against the British by playing upon people's fears of these Indian warriors.
The murder of Jane McCrae is retold and embellished in melodramatic paintings and exaggerated newspaper accounts. The story spreads throughout New England.
The Americans, who were masters of propaganda, said, here is a woman, a beautiful woman, who was a fiancée of one of the officers with Burgoyne. And Burgoyne's Indians scalped her. Now, if this is what's being done to the women who are allied with his own forces, what are they going to do with your wives and your children when they get here and they're coming? And the New England troops just turned out in droves.
The swelling American forces slow Burgoyne's progress. The rebels block the way with huge trees. They burn bridges and divert streams, turning Burgoyne's path into a swamp.
The enemy are at home here. They know this damn countryside, so they have a huge advantage. Every step for us, scouting, reconnoitering, brings new perils. Everywhere there are streams to cross and bridges to build, it takes a week to advance 1 mile.
The Americans do everything they can to impede his advance, to slow it, to make it expensive. And it is very slow, and it is very expensive in terms of labor and in terms of the British supplies consumed. The more you can stretch out the march of the army in time, the more of its own supplies that it's bringing with it, are being consumed by that army.
This is not the war of decisive battles, which Burgoyne has come to fight.
These supplies. For every hour I devote to figuring out how this army must fight, I have to spend 20 hours trying to figure out how to keep it fed.
Campaigning before the coming of the railway and before the coming of preserved food was a nightmare for generals, and it was their greatest problem. Fighting battles was easy. Supplying the armies while you marched them to the place where you were going to fight the battle was an absolute endless sort of scenario of difficulties for the general.
Desperate for supplies, Burgoyne's soldiers plunder nearby farms. This first contact with the army terrifies the civilian population. But the people are afraid not only of swords and bullets, they know that armies carry with them deadly diseases, especially that most terrible of killers, smallpox.
Language cannot describe the scenes of misery. I came across a large barn crowded full of men with this disorder. They lay in their own excrement, unable to see, speak, or walk. Abscesses formed on all parts of their body. Several had large maggots, an inch long, on every part of their body and crawling out of their ears. Death visits us every hour.
Diseases that occurred in epidemic proportions, such as diphtheria, smallpox, yellow fever, could decimate a population as much as 10 or 12% of the population could die in a very brief period of time. Smallpox inoculation in the 18th century consisted of taking a threaded needle, drawing the thread through an infected pustule, and then pulling the needle under the skin of a person who was not infected, thus infecting that person through inoculation.
But inoculation is unreliable. There is a real risk of dying from the procedure. Abigail Adams writes to John in Philadelphia.
My dearest friend, I am as healthy as I have ever been since my inoculation with the smallpox. All of my attention is devoted to the care of little Charles. We tried 3 times to inoculate him, but unfortunately they did not take, and now he has contracted the disease the natural way. He is very bad, John. The symptoms rose to a burning fever, stupefaction, and a delirium which has lasted 48 hours. Eruptions have taken place, and his face will be quite covered.
August 1st. Burgoyne and his troops have finally reached Fort Edward on the Hudson. It has taken one grueling month to go a mere 23 miles, and he has already lost a large number of his troops to disease. Before they can advance to Albany, they must wait until their supplies catch up with them.
Stuck here in the middle of nowhere, waiting for our supplies. Hot, so hot you couldn't breathe inside the tents. Everyone has dysentery. Have to keep on working if we want to stay alive.
Time is slipping away. Burgoyne hears of a large supply of horses near the town of Bennington, 12 miles east of the Hudson in what is now Vermont. He decides to send a company of soldiers to seize them. He expects no opposition.
We have reliable reports that 80% of the population are friends of the British cause. All they need to come out of hiding is the arrival of our army to protect them.
There's no doubt that Burgoyne exaggerated loyalist action and sentiment.
like many people, he believed the good news that he heard or that he was willing to create for himself and did not wish to hear bad news. He would not be the first nor the last general in history to do that.
To seize the horses near Bennington, Burgoyne dispatches 800 Hessian soldiers. The German horsemen put on their 20-pound riding boots and march off into the wilderness. At their head is Lieutenant Colonel Friedrich Bau. For someone who is to enlist the support of the loyalists, he is a strange choice. Lieutenant Colonel Bau does not speak one word of English.
Und General Burgoyne, wir haben 5 Gefangene genommen, die uns darüber informierten, dass 1.800 Männer in Bennington sind, die jedoch weglaufen werden, wenn wir uns annähern.
Baum had been told, don't worry, you see men in farm clothes with muskets, they're mostly loyalists coming to join you, so don't let them worry you. So he saw these Americans, old farmers going around with muskets on their shoulders. He thought they were coming in to help him, so he didn't do anything about it. Suddenly, the fighting started and they hit him from all sides.
It's a trap. The party is surrounded. Baum and all of his men are killed or captured.
I see my fellow countrymen on the ground, bleeding, shaking, crying for help. On the way we pass Colonel Baum lying almost naked in a cart, shot through the stomach. He is screaming in pain that the cart should go more slowly. But the Americans do not understand our language. The future frightens me. Here I am in a country in which everyone seems very enraged. What will become of me?
Burgoyne has miscalculated. Not only are most of the local farmers hostile to the British cause, worse, they are armed.
This was not anticipated by the British, because Britain was not a country of an armed people. The ordinary people were not allowed to carry weapons, and the notion of an entire countryside of farmers turning out with muskets to fight was quite alien to the British rural scene.
The great bulk of the country is with the Congress, in principle and zeal. New Hampshire, a country almost unpeopled in the last war, is now crawling with the most active, most rebellious race on the continent, and hangs like a gathering storm on my left.
He had to consider whether it was prudent to go on. The season was getting late, the New England militia were gathering, there was no evidence that Howe was going to support him adequately from the south. Reason should have suggested that he stop and that he abandon the expedition, and he didn't. Why? I think vanity. He said later on in the House of Commons, what would the army and the country have thought of me if I'd stopped?
In late August, General Howe's armada is sighted on Delaware Bay. His plan is to take Philadelphia, the capital, first, and then meet up with Burgoyne. The war is now advancing on two fronts. Washington and his army rush to Philadelphia's defense. Outside of Albany, members of the Northern militia are gathering to oppose Burgoyne. They are led by the very popular general, Horatio Gates. John Adams writes home from Philadelphia.
My dearest friend, Congress has sent Gates to take charge of the army in the North. This is what people from New England wanted. Now let them turn out in force. A fleet of 100 ships was seen off the Delaware Capes. Where, how, this scourge of God and plague of mankind is going to land, nobody can guess. But don't be anxious for my safety. When Howe comes to Philadelphia, I shall run away, I suppose, with the rest of Congress.
Dearest friend, we have not heard any news from the north. I long for some grand, important action somewhere. Burgoyne with his grand heirs must be humbled to the dust. The call for men is hurting the farm. My head negro has left in the middle of haying. What will I do now? I am not going to complain. If I have neither molasses, nor sugar, nor tea, nor coffee, I can live without them. As long as what I enjoy I share with my dearest partner, and with liberty.
Outside of Albany, the militia continue to pour in, reinforced by the soldiers who have fled Fort Ticonderoga. Burgoyne continues his advance. It takes him another month to reach Saratoga. From here, it seems easy. A road leads straight to his objective, Albany, 20 miles to the south. But there is a new crisis. Burgoyne's Indian scouts are deserting the army.
Once the campaign begins to be too long, and I think they probably sense before anyone else does, Americans or British, that this is going badly, they begin to drift away. They disappear. So by the time he gets into the real combat zone of this invasion, he's lost his screening force.
Without his Indian guides to serve as his eyes and ears, Burgoyne has no way of knowing where the enemy is or how strong their forces are. The American army, with its citizen soldiers of the New England militia, is now over 7,000 strong. Washington has sent Daniel Morgan and his formidable sharpshooters as reinforcements. They are encamped on a piece of land called Freeman's Farm, overlooking the only road to Albany. And now they wait. September 19th. Burgoyne's troops march into a clearing at Freeman's Farm. They see no American soldiers. Suddenly, from the surrounding woods, they hear a strange sound. Turkey gobbling. It is the secret code of Daniel Morgan's rifle corps. Their order, in flagrant breach of 18th century military etiquette, is to aim directly at the officers.
Several Americans place themselves in high trees, and when they see a British officer's uniform, they kill him by deliberately aiming at his person. Men, and particularly officers, drop on either side of me. The Americans, too, have heavy losses, but more and more of their reinforcements keep arriving.
Burgoyne is astounded. Not only has a huge army assembled from nowhere, worse, the Americans, whom he has called a mob of undisciplined provincials, are clearly able to fight. Burgoyne sends a frantic message to General Howe, who he assumes is still in New York.
The American army now between us and Albany outnumbers us. No operation, my lord, has yet been undertaken from New York to support us. There is no movement up the Hudson River. I never dreamed I would be left to make my way through this hostile countryside, surrounded by enemies, without any cooperation from New York. Burgoyne!
What was supposed to happen with Burgoyne and Howe in 1777 is a puzzle which historians have been teasing out. Ever since it happened, and it's still very far from clear. If Howe had seriously thought that Burgoyne's campaign depended on him, it wouldn't have been very difficult to make a detachment up the Hudson River to help him. Conversely, if Burgoyne had imagined that his success depended on what Howe was doing, one supposes he might have taken some steps to inform Howe of exactly where he intended to be and when, which he didn't.
Howe is having troubles of his own. His advance toward Philadelphia is meeting with stubborn resistance from Washington and the main American army. Howe fights and wins a fierce battle at Brandywine Creek. Both sides suffer heavy losses. Howe finally captures Philadelphia on September 26th. It is a hollow victory. Congress has fled.
In European terms, the capital is the seat of government, the seat of the monarch, and the mere threat of the loss of the capital would bring a government to terms. The same thinking must have influenced Howe's constant feeling that he ought to get Philadelphia, that Philadelphia was somehow the capital, whatever that might mean in America, and that this would perhaps be a solution and lead to a political settlement. But on the Americans went.
At Saratoga, Burgoyne is outnumbered 2-1, and the American forces continue to grow. He holds an urgent meeting with his generals. Baron von Riedesel and Simon Fraser urge him to retreat across the Hudson. Instead, Burgoyne orders another direct assault on the American army to force a passage to Albany.
Burgoyne was a gambler by temperament, loved gambling all his life. His temperament was not cautious. And as far as he was concerned, he was trying to execute a strategy which could work and which it was worth trying.
October 7th, 2:00 in the afternoon. The British begin their attack. At first, the American response is weak. General Gates refuses to leave his tent.
The minute Burgoyne showed up, Gates didn't know what to do. Gates' strength was as a paper shuffler. He could administer and work at a desk. He just was not a fighter. Once the battle began, he was worthless, literally, on the battlefield.
Seizing the initiative in the field and leading the counterattack is the most brilliant and fearless general of the American army, Benedict Arnold.
Arnold rides up and points his sword at the enemy. Morgan's men, urged on by Arnold, hurl themselves against the English and Germans with deadly fire from their rifles. I can't describe the bravery of Arnold on this battlefield. He's inspired with the fury of a demon.
3 years later, Arnold will become the Revolution's most famous traitor. But in 1777, at Freeman's Farm, he is its most heroic fighter. Arnold's horse is shot from under him. Seriously wounded, Arnold rallies his men to carry on the attack.
Arnold, as a field general, was electric to the men. And when he was there, they would do things no one else could get them to perform. And here he broke the line, the last line that Burgoyne had. With that, Burgoyne had to start to retreat.
The British officers, ignoring their own personal danger, lead their troops in one last stand.
General Fraser is hit. He was shot by a rifleman hiding in a tree. Everyone, from Burgoyne to the lowliest private, is stunned. He's faint, and he's losing blood. He asked if our army is defeated. We told him no. He appeared for the moment, pleased.
About 3 PM, we are waiting for our dinner guests. Instead, they bring in General Fraser on a litter. They clear the table and use it as a bed for the general. The ball has gone through the general's bowels. All night I hear him, lying there, groaning. All fatal ambition, and poor General Burgoyne and my poor wife. He dies at 8 o'clock the next morning.
The supply of rebels is inexhaustible. It's like Hydra's head. When you cut one snake off, seven more spring up in its place. For 3 weeks, no one has slept through the night. We are running low on rations. To keep spirits up, I have ordered the distribution of the last 12 barrels of rum.
October 10th, 2 p.m. We take refuge in the cellar. My children lie on the earth with their heads on my lap. The sounds of the battle are growing louder, and I am sitting in the corner, trembling. I am more dead than alive. Not so much because of my own danger as from worrying about my husband. Of all the women whose husbands have been killed or wounded, shall I be the only fortunate one?
We hear this huge sound, like the howling of dogs. At first we think it's a trick of the enemies, so we send out a detachment to reconnoitre. They come back and report to us. It's wolves. One sets up a cry when it finds a corpse. Then the others join it in that hideous sound as they rip it apart. The howling gets louder and louder.
On October 17th, in a field near Saratoga, the British lay down their arms. Burgoyne's entire army is taken prisoner. Gone are all his dreams of easy victory, honor, and glory.
General Gates met Burgoyne at the entrance to the camp. The fortune of war, General Gates, has made me your prisoner. Burgoyne drew his sword and handed it to Gates, who received it with a bow and returned it to its owner.
In their best military uniforms, with regimental colors flying, the British prisoners march into a clearing. They see, for the first time, the face of their conquerors. Row upon row of plainly dressed citizen soldiers, old men and young boys, free blacks, ordinary Americans. A British officer would write that he felt as if he were looking at a new race of men.
I rode post-haste from Nantes with the dispatches from America. I didn't have time to get off my horse when Franklin shouted to me, "Did Howe really take Philadelphia?" "Yes, sir," I said. And the poor gentleman sadly shook his head and was heading back to the house. I stopped him. "But, sir, I have greater news than that. General Burgoyne and his whole army are prisoners of war." The effect was electrical.
This is Franklin's moment of triumph. Saratoga has changed everything. He is finally received by the French court.
"To Catherine Green, your troubles will not last much longer. We have formed a treaty with the French. This alliance will serve to keep the English bull quiet and make him behave himself. His horns have been shortened. Benjamin Franklin."
The Americans now have as their ally one of the great superpowers of the world. For the British, it is a different story. They now face the prospect of a world war.
From the point of view of the British government, that meant a real war. a real war against a real enemy, an enemy that spoke a foreign language, a dangerous enemy, an enemy that might invade, an enemy that might overthrow the kingdom. Not just troublesome political issues, not just expensive and complex colonial problems, but real serious mortal peril.
To learn more about the American Revolution, the people, the times, and the world as it was, visit PBS Online at the address on your screen.
Tomorrow night on Liberty.
We were not created to be slaves.
The British exploit the South, but gain no real ground.
They couldn't hold territory. They couldn't cement loyalty. They couldn't restore the authority of the crown.
Out of this rabble rises a people who defy kings.
While American and French troops make history at Yorktown.
There's no stopping us. In we go.
American Revolution concludes tomorrow night at 9. You can see the entire three-part series and support the station that's bringing it to you beginning Sunday at 3. Now stay tuned for Charlie Rose.
Johnny has gone for a soldier.
Liberty, the American Revolution, is brought to you by Norwest. Banking, investments, and insurance. We care about our communities and the value of education, and are proud to support this series. Norwest, to the nth degree. Major funding is also provided by the National Endowment for the Humanities, expanding America's understanding of who we were, who we are, and who we will be. The Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. The Eberle Foundation. The Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
The Democracy Project.
To order Liberty, the American Revolution on video cassette, or Liberty, the companion book written by Thomas Fleming, call PBS Home Video at 1-800-828-4PBS.
This is PBS.
For a copy of the Liberty soundtrack on CD or cassette, call PBS Home Video at 1-800-828-4PBS. Performances by Mark O'Connor, Wynton Marsalis, Yo-Yo Ma, and James Taylor feature the music of the revolution heard in this series. The soundtrack includes the Liberty themes, Johnny Has Gone for a Soldier, and Song of the Liberty Bell.
Liberty on KCET is made possible by our members and the following. Foothill Capital Corporation, one of America's leading asset-based lenders, providing financing to companies across the United States and Canada. Foothill Capital Corporation, a Norwest company. If you'd like a free copy of the Viewer's Guide poster for the Liberty series, call KCET's Community Relations and Outreach Department. The number is 213-953-5788. One per family, please.